like us to begin this service in the traditional way people at the Findhorn community begin all significant group activities. This is known as an attunement. An attunement is a practice which helps people focus people's attention and align their energies with the purpose which the group has gathered together. There is a way people at Findhorn have of ensuring that when people hold hands, everyone's hands are facing the right way, and that is to bring your hands together in front of you, turn them so that your thumb is pointing to the right, and then slide them apart. So let us now take a moment to close or lower our eyes or focus on our child's way. Think about the purpose for which we are gathered here. I invite you to relax and let go of any thoughts that do not relate to this moment, and let our thoughts be clear and open. We will now have a brief moment of silence to focus on this. We are now gathered to spend this hour together, exploring, contemplating, and learning. Let us create together an atmosphere of trust and support. Hello everyone, and welcome to our service today, which is on the topic of introducing the Findhorn community. Some of you might well be wondering what Findhorn is, or you've heard me talk about it, and are curious. There are some pictures on the back of the order of service. I feel I should apologise slightly to those of you who got the ones that printed off after the ink cartridge started running out, but I'll be happy to describe them. People have asked me, what is Findhorn? I suppose I should start by saying that Findhorn itself is a small village in Scotland. So for the rest of this service, I'll be trying to remember to refer to this as the Findhorn community, which is distinct from the village, because the people of the village, which has been there for hundreds of years, do like you to do that. So if I forget, please call me up afterwards. So I'll talk about the history of the Findhorn community shortly, but first I'd like to invite Ben and Diana to come up and light the chalice and read our chalice words.
As we light this chalice and gather together as a community of spiritual explorers, let us think of the three founding beliefs of the Findhorn community: co-creation with nature, inner listening and attunement, and love in action. May we seek to learn from others and from each other.
In a slight change to how we often do things here, before we sing our first hymn, I'd like us all to begin the service in the traditional way that people at the Findhorn community begin all their significant group activities, and this is called an attunement. An attunement is a practice which helps to focus everybody's attention and try to align their personal energies and thoughts with the purpose for which the group has gathered together. You'll notice that I've got us sitting in a circle. This is a big part of how things are done at Findhorn. We like to have everyone in a circle as a circle of equals and friends. Traditionally, attunements are done with the participants holding hands. So I'm now going to mess up Brian's filming by coming around and just showing everybody how to do this. Sorry, Brian. So now let me tell you a little about the Findhorn community. It was, interestingly enough, it was unintentionally founded. And the founders were three people, a married couple, Peter and Eileen Caddy, and their friend Dorothy McLean. It was founded in 1962. All three people had dedicated themselves to following a disciplined spiritual path for many years. They first came to northeast Scotland in 1957 to manage the Clooney Hill Hotel in the town of Forest. Eileen received guidance in her meditations from an inner source she called the Still Small Voice Within, and Peter ran the hotel according to this guidance and his own intuition. Clooney Hill swiftly became a thriving and successful four-star hotel, but after several years, the hotel company terminated Peter and Eileen's employment unexpectedly. With nowhere to go and not very much money, they moved their three young sons and their friend Dorothy to a caravan park in the nearby coastal village of Findhorn. If you have a quick look at the order of service, there should be a picture there of the original caravan, which the community has kept as a sort of memorial to the pioneering spirit. There was a small annex on the side where Dorothy lived, and I'd like everyone to just take a moment to imagine living in that caravan in the middle of a Scottish winter. They were either desperate, determined, or very probably both at the same time. Feeding six people on unemployment benefit was difficult, so Peter decided he should grow vegetables. During her meditations, Dorothy discovered she was able to intuitively contact what she called the overmighty intelligence of plants. She referred to these guiding intelligences that she perceived, firstly as angels, and then gave them the name Devas, which is after a Hindu word meaning nature spirits. They guided her and Peter on how to make the most of their garden. In the very barren, sandy soil of the Findhorn Bay Caravan Park, and it really is very barren and very sandy, you can kick it and see sand, they grew huge plants, herbs and flowers, most famously the now legendary 40-pound cabbages. I can only imagine they ate a lot of cabbage soup. News of what was happening soon spread fast. Other people came to join the caddies and Dorothy in their work. Soon the original group of six people grew into a small community, committed to their spiritual path and to expanding their garden in harmony with nature. In the late 1960s, Peter and other community members, in accordance with Eileen's guidance, built the Park Sanctuary, which is the largest of the community's meditation sanctuaries, and the community centre, which the community still uses to meet in, eat together in, and hold social events. In 1970, a young American spiritual teacher named David Spangler arrived in the community, and with his partner Myrtle Vines, he helped to define and organise a programme of spiritual learning. In 1972, the community, the Findhorn Foundation, was formally registered as a charity, and in the 1970s and 1980s it grew to approximately 300 members. In 1975, the foundation purchased the Feeney Hill Hotel where the caddies had worked to use as a centre for workshops and for members' accommodation, and in 1983 they purchased the entire caravan park. Peter Caddy left the community in 1979 to work internationally, but he came back to visit Findhorn regularly until his death in Germany in 1994. Eileen Caddy lived a long and inspiring life in the community and died peacefully at home in 2006. Dorothy McLean lived in North America for a number of years and was actively involved in leading workshops around the world. She is now retired to Findhorn and still lives within the community. At the end of the 1980s, the Eco Village project at Findhorn began, contributing significantly to the development of the Eco Village movement worldwide. An eco village is defined as a community which is ecologically, economically, culturally and spiritually sustainable, and they saw it as a logical development of their community's work with spirit and nature. They now have 90 ecological buildings, 3 wind generators, and a biological sewage treatment plant known as the Living Machine, which you can get tours of if you go to the Findhorn community. Somehow we never quite found the time to take that. In 1995, the Findhorn community and the evolving worldwide eco-village network organised a conference at Findhorn, Eco-Villages and Sustainable Communities, the 21st Century. From this initiative, the global eco-village network was established, with the foundation becoming one of its founding members. Since then, the Findhorn Foundation College has been established to provide a vehicle for academic programmes and to host students and study groups both from the local area and from around the world. In 1997, the United Nations recognised the Findhorn Foundation formally as a non-governmental organisation. The Findhorn Unitarian Network, which has the happy acronym FUN, was established in 2017 by Reverend Ralph Katz, who some of you will have met. He's a full Unitarian. He saw links between the beliefs of the Findhorn community and those held by many UK Unitarians. The community offers the people the chance to go and live there for a week on what they call an experience week. There have been 2 Findhorn Unitarian Network experience weeks so far, one being the one I went on earlier this year. The next one is scheduled for May 2019. So I've talked a bit there about the beliefs of the founding members, and I think it will be apparent from that brief history that seeking inner guidance, or what's often referred to as inner listening, as you heard in the chalice reading that was read out by Diana, that's a fundamental part of life in the community. As we just did there, holding hands, that's pretty much how every group activity at Findhorn starts. Everybody takes a moment to acknowledge everyone's presence, hold hands, and just seek inner guidance to focus on what they're about to do. I should also say that Findhorn community members differ in their beliefs, much as Unitarians do, and as we do amongst ourselves. Like us, they have three principles they are committed to, which we've heard in our chalice reading, but also like us, every member is free to follow their own conscience and freedom of belief. Some members of the Findhorn community really do believe in a wide variety of spiritual beings, angels, spirits, devas, many other supernatural beings, just as the founding members did. Others at Findhorn see these beings as aspects of a greater divine spirit. Others see them as aspects of your own inner spiritual being speaking to you in that form. Everybody, however, sees it as being essential to continually seek spiritual guidance, whether they're on their own or within the group. And with that in mind, I'd like us now to play a very simple game, which is called the Angel Game. This was developed by two members of the Findhorn community, Kathy Tyler and Joy Drake. So you can see on the table in front of us, we have several angel cards. Each of these cards has got a keyword on it, as you'll see when you pick one up, relating to an aspect of somebody's inner life. The game's authors describe it by saying, you can pick a card at the beginning of a new cycle of life or new venture. You can pick one with a particular task in mind, an obstacle to overcome, or just to give you a direction to focus on for a particular amount of time. So what I would like everyone to do is just take a moment to think about yourselves, where you are now, where we are now as a community, both physically and spiritually, and just what we want to create or achieve in future. This can be a big goal, it could be like taking on a new job, or it could be a smaller goal, like writing a poem, or chairing a meeting, or anything you're thinking about doing at the moment. What people feel matters to you right now is what matters. And if you feel unable to rise and come to the table in future, I'll be happy to bring over the pack of cards that have it actually. I didn't actually have room for all of them on the table, but I believe most of them are there, so I'll bring those over. So can I just ask everyone just to take a few moments, pause, and think about what matters. So now, I'm taking a few moments to pause and think about what matters to each of us at this moment. Let us now think about just connecting with our inner spiritual voice and seeking some guidance or inspiration. When everyone feels ready, please walk up to the table and choose a card. You can see if there is a card you feel especially drawn to, but don't worry too much about that. Just walk up and choose one when you feel ready. And I shall go first. So now let us all take a moment just to look at our cards, focusing on the keyword and reflecting how this quality can all help us achieve what matters to you. If you like, you can think about what the little angel shown on your card, if it suddenly appeared to you, might give you as a gift. And the authors say this could be a word, it could be an image, or just a feeling. You can keep these little cards with you throughout the service. Please, everyone, just pop them back on the table afterwards. If you want to tell everybody now what you've got, you're most welcome to do. But don't feel you have to, I'm going to. I'm smiling because the card I have pulled is faith, which to me seems very appropriate at this moment in time. And I don't know if anybody else wishes to share which card they've got.
I'm sure
I might. Go on then, what are you?
It's got nothing on it at all.
Well, perhaps that shows you, though, isn't it? Yeah. Perhaps that shows you that you've got freedom to create whatever you want. They're nice, aren't they? There's one of an angel about to go diving. One of these days I'll pull that one.
I've got surrender.
Interesting.
Mm-hmm. I've got to expect.
I've got trust.
I've got power.
I've interestingly says freedom.
It occurs to me that I haven't actually given David a chance to draw a card. Okay. So we've now all drawn our little angels to guide us. And on that note, let's all pick up our hymn books and sing our second hymn, number 128 in the purple book again, Our World is One World. So now let me speak a little bit more about one of the other founding principles of the Findhorn community, What is love in action? I've mentioned that love in action is a key part of life at the Findhorn community. For visitors, like myself and the other Unitarians on the Experience Week, it takes the form of dedicating 4 mornings during your visit to working in the community, whether this is hoovering out the community centre, weeding the gardens, or cooking in the Foonie Hotel's kitchens. You might be wondering why this is classed as a spiritual practice. The Findhorn community's explanation is like this. Work is an opportunity to bring our whole selves and our highest love into the practical business of daily life. By bringing full, loving engagement into each task, moment by moment, we can shape a new consciousness for ourselves, our community, and the world. Love where you are. Love what you're doing. Love who you're doing it with. This is the founder Peter Caddy's explanation of the Findhorn community practice of work is love in action. You will perhaps see on the back of the orders of service that there are pictures at the bottom of the 3 founding members. Peter Caddy was a former military officer who led by example. He insisted that all community members bring this attitude into everyday activity, whether this was just raking up the leaves, harvesting the vegetables, or making key decisions. One can't help thinking that when they founded the community, this must also have been a very useful way of establishing who was truly committed to making the community work and those who were perhaps less committed. It does take a certain determination to get up in the dark of a Scottish morning and go and hoe the vegetables. But with this attitude, people discovered that each day can become an opportunity for growth and discovery when we bring our highest spiritual aspiration and love to it. Also, when we act with love and clear intention, life meets us with the right resources, people, and realisations. An example of this that the community likes to talk about was in their early days. Peter Caddy, acting on his inner guidance, bought several bungalows with borrowed money, although there weren't actually any people there at the time who needed housing. So this was quite a gamble for a community without many resources. But within weeks, the bungalows were full of people who wanted to live as part of the exciting experiment that was happening at the Findhorn community. The bungalows are still there, put around the original caravan. Today, members of the community continue to try to bring love and mindfulness to every moment, no matter how seemingly ordinary. Those of you like me who take an interest in mindfulness will notice that this is quite similar to the way in which some mindfulness teachers will say you can bring mindfulness to everyday activities. You can have a mindful shower, a mindful hoovering of the floor, or a mindful making of a cake, and that last one's my favourite. Before each work shift, community members share whatever is needed to bring themselves present, and then hold an attunement like we did at the start. As we've seen, that's a brief meditation to align people with each other, with the task at hand, and invite the cooperation of all partners, seen and unseen. The practice of love in action is a recognition that everything we do, even small things, is an opportunity to move beyond any previously limiting beliefs and to try to shape a new future. The Findhorn community story of a small band of spiritual seekers growing into a flourishing, internationally respected spiritual learning centre and community is a demonstration, as they see it, of the power of putting love into action. The community's members believe that this story is just the beginning. The vision is nothing less than a world where each human being manifests their highest love, and in doing so becomes a unique blessing for all life. So we will now have a period of quiet meditation and contemplation, followed by a musical interlude. I'll begin with a short reading for Eileen Caddy, one of the Findhorn community's founders. Then we'll have a few moments of silence and then a musical interlude. Eileen said many words of wisdom, and this was something that came to her when she was meditating, and she called it, "Consider the wonder of it all and give thanks." When you pull up a weed or pick a berry off a bush, do you do it with your eyes closed and your heart closed as well? Or do you consider the wonder of it all and give thanks for it, and thrill to the newness of it every time? How can anyone be bored with so many wonders all around, there for all to share when they can stop and take time to do so? Ours is a glorious life, a life full of wonder and glory, full of joy and fun and happiness. Look for the very best in everything and bring out that very best. It is there. All it needs is drawing out. And now, let us pick up our hymn books once more and sing hymn number 216, Wide Green World. Most epic stories start with a leaving of home, a travelling through strange lands, the coming together of new companions and the facing of new and challenging experiences. Though Scotland is not that strange a land, the journey I made to the Findhorn Foundation from Newcastle is certainly epic. It takes in the northeast coastline, then cuts inland through the snowy Cairngorms, and finally emerges out on the Moray Firth's coastline. It probably won't surprise you to learn that, being me, I did have a quick look and learned that whilst there are whales around there, nobody's currently mad enough to be diving in that part of the world in January. The Findhorn Foundation sits on the sandy peninsula near Inverness. It's actually quite surprisingly warm in January. Findhorn seems to have its own little microclimate, but that is relative to the rest of Scotland, and I've spent the week thankful that I equipped myself with my walking boots and a very nice fluffy thermal hat from the Black Store in Inverness. As I've said earlier, the Findhorn community is now nearly 60 years old, which is quite an achievement given that many communities founded around that time have come to a natural end. As I've said earlier, its members hold many differing beliefs, but like us with our three principles of freedom, reason and tolerance, they have their three principles in a listening, love in action and co-creation with the intelligence of nature. And the point of Experience Week is for visitors to learn how the community lives all of these values. It aims to give people coming to Findhorn, including the 17 Unitarians who had all signed up to the Fun Week, a chance to experience some of the community's daily life and beliefs. Inner listening is so fundamental to Findhorn life that they have several sanctuaries dedicated to just providing people with space to do this. I actually spent some time helping to clean them. Every activity and day starts with an attunement like the one we did at the start of this service. And by the end of the week, those of us in the fun group were attuning like pros, doing the fin. We quickly nicknamed it the Findhorn Salute. We were holding hands and many of us started hugging each other. It probably does help that Findhornians, I don't know if they call themselves that, but I like the word, they also like to start all of their gatherings by lighting a candle. I've put ours in the middle so that we can focus on it as they do. Candles are a big part of Findhorn life. They have some especially beautiful ones. You may see pictures of them if you ever see material produced by Findhorn, which are designed to be smokeless, and when they burn, they leave almost a little trace of like lace when the wax slowly melts down. I was actually on the home care part of the Findhorn community team whilst I was doing my love in action. And the chap there was an extremely jovial man who did the organising and clearly seen it all. And I asked him, these smokeless candles, I've seen them in the shop, they're not the cheapest candles, are they? And he said, well, yeah, but we were spending ages trying to clean off all the stuff off the roof. And the cleaning staff sounded like they're all on 50 a day. As I've just said, another fundamental aspect of the week was to join in sustaining the community by contributing to its maintenance through love and action. I was lucky in that I had the unusual opportunity to actually work with two teams, the Park Home Care team, who I've just mentioned, and the Clooney Hotel Kitchen. Just to make it clear, the community actually consists of two sites, and one is the Park Village, which is on the site of the original caravan park. And the other is the Clooney Hotel, which is about a 20-minute drive away, which is the hotel where two of the founders originally worked before they were asked to leave their employment. It might seem odd to pay to go on a week and then go and do the housework, which quite a few people remarked to me when I told them about the Experience Week. But if you don't do that, you're missing out on the chance to become part of the community whilst you're there, meet ordinary people from it, but well, ordinary people who are permanently resident within the Findhorn community, and other people who are visiting for the experience week, like yourself. Some of my happiest moments from the week involved wielding the Henry Hoover around the Parks Community Centre. I think you can see a picture of it in the order of service. I actually also really enjoyed working in the Thuny Hotel's kitchens. For me, as somebody who loves cooking, it was quite enjoyable to be in a professional kitchen. And the people there were absolutely lovely. I met one lady there who had come to Findhorn on and off throughout her life to try and regenerate herself and refresh herself. When I was there, she was recovering from a car accident, and I asked her how she was doing, and she said that having come here, she was nearly ready to go back and face the world. I also rather wish I'd had time, or space really, to put on the order of service one of my favourite pictures of Findhorn, which is that I was there with another Unitarian called Joe O'Sullivan. Those of you who've been to the GA may have met Joe. She and I spent quite a while doing the washing up in the Clooney Hotel kitchens, and at the end of it we came out to eat and saw that on the menu somebody had chalked at the bottom of the chalkboard, lentil soup, cheesy, eggy, beany, fry thing, it's nice, you'll enjoy it. Bye bye Joe and Louise, we love you. So now I'd like to talk a little bit more about how people at Findhorn try to co-create with nature. Obviously, I've told you in the history just how fundamental that was, well, pretty much to their, almost to their survival, really, when they started. They needed the six people there when they started needed to eat, and if they hadn't been able to grow enough food to feed themselves, they'd have been quite a dire situation. The community describes this value as follows. Our planet is alive and aware. By communicating and working with the rest of nature, humans can find and bring new and creative solutions to life. So we saw how the community tries to live in harmony with nature. We saw it in action in our tour of the community, which takes place on the second day of the experience week. So you go for a good yomp around the park village, taking in things like community centres, the meditation sanctuaries, the giant gardens. Findhorn is nearly self-sufficient but does import some things. They decided a while ago to look at moving beyond just growing and also to fund themselves through having a college and a cleaning hotel. But the gardens are still very much part of Findhorn's life, and they're also moving into housing, trying to build a new eco-village for people to come and live in. And we also saw the famous barrel houses, which are among the oldest buildings in the entire park village. When it became apparent they needed more space than the caravan and the bungalows, they realised they needed to build houses out of materials that were available. So these are houses which are made out of gigantic whiskey barrels. They date back right back to the start, and apparently at that time there was quite some debate within the community as to whether this was actually an appropriate thing for them to be doing. They had quite strict rules about not drinking alcohol or taking drugs within the communities, and so people asked, was it really appropriate to be using whiskey barrels? The argument was won when other people pointed out that the community was all about being eco-friendly and recycling, and the whiskey barrels were a local renewable resource. We had two focalisers, which is a Findhorn word that means something like a facilitator, someone who takes care of a group doing something and tries to focus them on what they're doing and look after the members. We had two of them, Judith and Craig, supporting them on our experience week. And Craig actually lives in an original barrel house, which he's built on throughout the years and uses as both his home and his pottery studio. If you're picturing a home which looks like something out of The Hobbit, you've pretty much got the right idea. And on the walk around the park village, which was somewhat chilly since it decided to rain, we called in at Craig's home to admire it and see his pottery and get out of the rain for a bit and sit around the fire. And eating buttered oat cakes and drinking ginger and apple tea in Craig's home was one of the highlights of our week. Many people at Findhorn, though not all of them, follow pagan traditions. Whilst we were there, several others took part in the celebration of Imolc, or St. Bridget's Day. You might remember from the spring miscellany I talked a little bit about Imolc, and Tony McNeil has given a service on it in the past. This is a celebration that occurs halfway between the winter solstice and the spring equinox, It's the celebrating of the beginning of spring and the promise of new life as we emerge out of the cold and dark of winter. The Findhorn Emerald celebration involves everybody who is able to take part gathering in the park's garden polytunnels, which are giant, these are gigantic greenhouses made out of polythene on frames. They're the sorts of things that industrial growers use to produce vegetables. We gather in there and there's a short ceremony with attunements, readings, music and songs. And then everyone present takes some seeds from a bowl held by the service leader, holds them, says a few words of blessing over them, then kneels down to plant them in the soil and cover them up with some earth. I like to think that the turnips I planted are growing there at present and will one day nourish the community in the form of some soup. Among the many traditions associated with Bridget's Day is the traditional passing through Bridget's girdle, which is represented by a piece of rope held by two women from the community. People gather in a circle, walk around, walk through the girdle and chant a blessing, asking for Bridget to look after them and bless their endeavours during the year to come. It's a ceremony symbolising rebirth and new beginnings. And at the start of 2018, for us to be part of the Findhorn community, even for a week, was a privilege, and perhaps the start of something new within Unitarianism. I have talked a great deal, which obviously is part of the description of what I'm doing here today by leading the service. What I'm going to do now is tell you a bit more about what people other than me thought about their week at Findhorn. But I'll leave us a few minutes, and if people have got questions for me or just want to talk about anything we've done here today, I'm happy to do that. But I've talked about my perspective on it, so I thought it would be good to hear a bit from some other people. One person just really enjoyed everything about it. She said the highlights were the wonderful vegetarian food and the comfortable accommodation, Taizé chanting every morning at 8 a.m. in the nature sanctuary. Actually, I should have mentioned that earlier. Findhorn days start early and finish early because, Scottish winters, not a lot of daylight. She enjoyed the early morning meditation in the park sanctuary, the wonderful full moon at Imok on the 1st of February, and the community celebrations, and a trip to Randall's Leap, which is a stunning waterfall on the Findhorn River. That's somewhere that one of the other founders of the community liked to go for walks to try and connect with the earth spirit. So a visit there is part of everybody's experience week at Findhorn. It's a stunningly lovely place and very, very calming, but a good place to connect with nature. What another person's comments were, it's well worth the travel. I think attunement should be used everywhere for everything. Love in action transforms our obligations into joys, most of the time. We can and do change at any moment. We can always be better today than we were yesterday. Also, my preconceived ideas about what a didgeridoo sounds like have been completely blown away, and it's my new favourite instrument. Another person there found the week quite challenging, which it is. I'm aware that I've changed a couple of aspects of our worship today, and I don't know if that was challenging for anyone, but I think there is always that element of challenge and perhaps overcoming oneself whenever you try anything new spiritually. I've included this quote because it rang true for me. The experience we've had might not be enjoyed by all Unitarians, given the difficulty many have with what some would dismiss as New Age spirituality, as they hold on perhaps a little too tightly to their much valued reason and need for clearly defined religious practice. One of the key things I discovered was that I had quite a bit more of that in me than I had realised, and I was not always as open to the spiritual paths of others as I thought I was. Another person told me that their favourite memories were, before setting off for the gardens in the morning, I went to the 8 a.m. Taizé singing sessions held in the nature sanctuary. It was a joyful, uplifting way to start the day. Before starting work in the gardens and at the end of these sessions, there was the attunement, and when holding hands in the circle, I felt a deep connection to my inner self, to the others within the circle and with all that is. Another said he had taken away the following learning points. I didn't realise how global Findhorn's reach is with resource people in most countries around the world. These are people who have lived in Findhorn or visited several times. They know the foundation and the community well. Just to clarify, the foundation is the registered charity. The community is much broader and is basically everybody who lives at Findhorn. And they're very enthusiastic about taking the inspiration they found here out into their own activities in the local area. There are some around here. There's one in Cumbria, Scotland and North Yorkshire. And whilst they weren't able to come here and join us, they did send me some of the material I've used for the service. The person who said that also went on to say, Craig, one of the vocalisers who guided the group through the week, said to us on the last day that he liked the crazy Unitarians because he thought they were a lot like us. Love in action turned out to be a quiet takeaway for me. I used it to turn chores into things which matter and have purpose. And it changes the quality of the work done and reduces the stress of doing what needs to be done, for me anyway. Another comment was, I felt mutually non-judgmental encouragement of each other and a supportive atmosphere within the group throughout my stay. It was very meaningful for me. It's something that is lacking in wider society, I feel, as we tend to passively rely on being entertained by TV or radio or concerts, which can miss out on the social aspects of entertainment, the mutual exchange of talents and entertainment within a social group, and the bonding that forms through this. And one more person said, I think each of us found lessons and practices to take home for ourselves and our chapels and churches to enrich our personal and organisational lives. How wonderful it would be if world powers adopted the approaches we learned at Findhorn to address the world's challenges. So I hope that this short introduction to the Findhorn community and its three principles has helped us all think a little bit about how we might meet some of the challenges we face as individuals and as a group, with hope, determination, and love. And now, I don't know if anyone has any questions or anything they'd like me to expand on, but I'm happy to discuss if anyone does.
I'd just like to say thank you very much for sharing your experience. And I think it's really interesting coming just 2 weeks after the tree service that our other Louise also differs. And what I'm particularly enjoying whilst I listen to your experience is the fact that perhaps by accident we've used a wooden table with a beautiful wooden chalice that holds the candle and reminds us that that connection to nature that you're describing is so crucial to Findhorn. It feels like it's feeding me and reminding me, because these are aspects of tree that I also remember from Louise's service, saying just bringing a piece of wood in reminds us of that connection. So, you know, it's really nice to have two members of the community sharing experiences and knowledge and bringing it to us. Thank you very much, both of you.
I was just wondering what it is that's being taught at the college, and it just as an outline. Maybe something you didn't.
That's not something we got into in great detail, because we were there for a week, and if you move to Newcastle, you can scratch the surface in a week. Findhorn's smaller, but there's still a lot there we didn't really get into. I was also a little bit aware that there was some of the inner politics of Findhorn that we weren't necessarily seeing, because obviously we were coming in. In terms of the college, it runs the experience weeks. There were very many courses there. Some that I looked at were things like how to lead a spiritual community, how to establish eco-villages. It's quite a lot about the eco-village movement, which I mentioned a bit earlier. Yeah. They also run, I suppose, the sorts of things you might suppose expect, things like natural healing, alternative medicines, and so on. They do have a full prospectus on their website if you really want to get into it. As we come now toward the end, I was trying to decide what the closing words were and realised that by a very neat coincidence, this is our service which is nearest the festival of Beltane, which is the Celtic Spring Festival following Imol, the festival which, as I said, was celebrated during my time at Findhorn. Those of us who've seen Tony McNeill lead services on the topic of Beltane will know that this is a fire festival, a celebration of spring's presence, and a time of creativity, fertility, and new beginnings. We actually have here two symbols of Beltane, these beautiful flowers. Flowers are a big symbol of Beltane as they promise, they have the promise of fruit later to come in the year. And obviously we have our own small flame burning there in our chalice. I'd like to conclude the service today with a traditional Gaelic prayer for Beltane. But having done, but before I do that, I feel we should have our final hymn, which is the hymn number 158, The Flame of Truth is Kindled. So let us conclude today with a traditional Gaelic prayer for Beltane, after which we will have a closing attunement. Bless, O threefold, true and bountiful, myself, my family, my friends. Bless everything within my dwelling and in my possession. Bless the animals and plants, the flocks and the corn, from Samhain Eve to Beltane Eve, with goodly progress and gentle blessing. From sea to sea and every river mouth, from wave to wave and base of waterfall, satisfy my soul and shield my loved ones, blessing everything and everyone, all my land and my surroundings. Great divinity, taking many forms, who creates and brings life to all, I ask for your blessing on this day of fire and creation. Amen.